Once again, it's time to get smart. You know, I figured out this morning that if we just show a little bit more of that video, we could watch the whole thing in a couple of months around here. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Proverbs chapter 2. I got to be honest with you. I keep thinking, okay, this week I'm going to get into the really practical stuff. We're going to talk about what Proverbs has to say about relationships, what Proverbs has to say about money. And then I read in the next chapter, and there's something else I've got to talk to you about. There's something else I got to teach you before I can ever get into that stuff. And so today we're going to talk about change. You guys remember when you were a kid and the how many does it take to change the light bulb jokes? You guys remember those? You know how many bankers it takes to change a light bulb? How many bankers? It takes three. One to hold the bulb and two to remember the combination. A little bit to the right, a little bit to the left, a little bit to the... Okay, that one wasn't very good. You know how many Kansas City Chiefs it takes to change a light bulb? It takes 11. 11. It takes one to hold the bulb and 10 to pick up the fumbles. I thought that one was pretty good. You know how many lawyers it takes to change a light bulb? How many can you afford? That's the big question. Last one. I would do one more. Do one more. Do you know how many Baptists it takes to change a light bulb? It takes 10. It takes 5 to plan the potluck dinner to talk about it, 3 to serve on the committee to finance it, 1 to actually change the bulb, and 1 to complain about how much they like the old light bulb better. See, you guys know that one's pretty close to true. That one's pretty close to the truth. But we're not here to talk about changing light bulbs. Here's the real question for today. How many light bulbs does it take to change a person? You guys remember the cartoons, comic strips and cartoons, anytime somebody got that idea, that flash of insight, it always had a light bulb above their head. How many light bulbs does it take to change me? How many light bulbs have to go up? How many insights, how much wisdom do I need in order to really change, to bring about meaningful, lasting change in our lives? How many light bulbs have to go off? Well, we've been looking at the book of Proverbs, and if you've been missing it, you can go online and you can check out under our media. You can go back and you can watch the previous series, the previous sermon series that's part of it. But Solomon, the wisest and richest man in chapter 2, he's going to give us the key to change. He's going to help us understand what has to take place in our life. And the truth is, there's only one thing necessary, and that is that we understand and embrace and apply the wisdom of God. And that wisdom of God is revealed to us in the book of Proverbs. We need to be a people that are open to change. We need to be a people that know we need to change. Anybody know who Red Green is? PBS has a comedy that comes on called The Red Green Show. And Red Green, some of you are clapping out there like you've watched Red Green before. And the end of the Red Green Show, they always go back to the Possum Lodge, and they do the men's pledge at the Possum Lodge, and Red Green says, "I can change," or they all repeat, "I can change," and then they go, "If I have to." And you know, sometimes that's our attitude. We can change if we have to. I'm here to tell you today, we need to change because we need to. We need to change because we want to. Repeat this after me, "I can change." Now, I know that's a change for some of you to repeat something out loud when you go to church. We're going to do it one more time, give you a chance to change right here. Repeat it after me. I can change. All right. Proverbs chapter 2, as we get into it, what you're going to discover is that Solomon gives us a conditional principle. It's noted by if-then kind of conversation. If this happens, then you can expect this. If this happens, then. It is an if-then setup for us. That says, if these conditions are met, then you can expect this kind of return, or this kind of response, or this kind of reaction. It is very clear in Proverbs chapter 2 that what Solomon is talking about here, what the Lord is speaking to us through Solomon, is that you and I we are in fact capable of changing. That we can change our relationship with God, we can change our relationships with each other, we can change our lives, we can change our finances, provided we apply the principles that we discover in God's Word, we'd apply His wisdom to our life. I can change. You can change. Repeat it one more time. I can change. All right, Proverbs chapter 2. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Proverbs chapter 2. All right, let's begin. Let me read it to you beginning in verse 1. Listen to what it says. Now, Solomon is going to, the Lord is going to speak to us through Solomon, and Solomon is going to play the role of a father speaking to his children. So we're talking about an intimate relationship that he is sharing with us. It's like me calling my children together and saying, you know what, in the world you're going to experience this kind of stuff, and I'm here to tell you how to deal with it. You're going to experience those moments in your life when you're going to look up and you're going to go, I need to change this. How do I do it? Solomon's getting ready to tell us. Listen to what it says. My son, if you receive my words, notice the if there? If you receive my words and treasure my commands within you, so that you incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding, yes, if you cry out for discernment and lift up your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord. Now remember, we've already covered what the fear of the Lord is. It is the beginning of wisdom. It is that elementary principle that we embrace that leads us to understand who God is and how God's way works. So then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From His mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright and a shield to those who walk uprightly. He guards the paths of justice and preserves the way of His saints. Then you will understand righteousness and justice, equity, and every good path. When wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you and understanding will keep you to deliver you from the way of evil, from the man who speaks perverse things, from those who leave the paths of righteousness to walk in the ways of darkness, those who rejoice in doing evil and delight in the perversity of the wicked, whose ways are crooked and who are devious in their paths, to deliver you from the immoral woman and from the seductress who flatters with her words, who forsake the companion of her youth and forget the covenant of her God. For her house leads down to death and her path to the dead. None who go to her return, nor do they regain the paths of life. So you may walk in the way of goodness and keep the path of righteousness. For the upright will dwell in the land, the blameless will remain in it, but the wicked will be cut off from the earth, and the unfaithful will be uprooted from it. Go back one more time to verse 5. We've gone to all these ifs. And verse 5 says, then you will understand the fear of the Lord. I can change. I can change. I can change. God's word can make a difference in my life. It can make a difference in our church. It can make a difference in our families. It can make a difference in our community. It can make a difference in our world if we meet the conditions. Then we can expect the results. Think with me for just a few minutes about this fact that I can change. Roman number 1 in your outline, I can change. Number 1, if I am God's child, I can change. If I am God's child, I can change. Notice how Solomon begins this passage. He says, my son, if you receive my words. The first principle that has to be embraced is that we must become a child of God. There is no real lasting change apart from a relationship with Him. There is no real lasting change apart from being in a relationship with the person of Jesus Christ. My son, receive my words. You know, the Bible teaches us that a lost man, a lost woman, someone that does not know God in a personal way, that there are spiritual truths that they can't even begin to grasp and understand. The Bible says that there are certain things that God wants us to understand that can only be understood when we have a relationship with Him. So the first step in that light bulb going off that says, I can change, and this is how I can change, the first step is becoming His child. Now, you know, many of us, though, I don't know about you, but I've tried to change my life. I've decided in my own mind, in my own ability, by my own wisdom, I'm going to make some changes. But what I've discovered is that the changes that I can bring about on my own are temporary at best. Has anybody besides me ever tried to change and you find yourself going through that process over and over again because you keep failing at it? Let me see your hands if you've ever done that. And then pretty soon what you do is you just give up. You stop even trying. Let me tell you something. God does not make Me failing is not a deal breaker with God. Me messing up, making a mistake, me falling down is not the deal breaker. You see, if I try, if I get back up and I continue to try, then I'm still ahead of those who refuse to try. But the reality is, my God wants me to change. He wants me to change my attitude and my actions, and the way that that comes about, the first way that that comes about is through having a relationship with Him that only comes through the person of Jesus Christ. My son, if you receive my words, then these things will take place. If you receive my words, then these things will happen. Listen, I don't care what you've done in your past. It doesn't matter what your past looks like. It doesn't matter how many mistakes. It doesn't matter what struggle you find yourself in today. You can change, and your life can change. But you have to do it God's way. First step, you must be a child of God. If I'm God's child, I can change. Second thing, if I stop settling for life as it is, I can change. If I stop settling, the first one is I've got to be in a relationship with God. The second is I've got to want to change. The enemy to change is not mistakes or defeat. The enemy of change is complacency. If you go back in chapter 1, just a few verses, listen to what it says in verse 32. For the wisdom has been speaking, this wisdom of God, this light bulb that goes off that changes us. Wisdom has been speaking. And then she says, for the turning away of the simple will slay them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. Here's the problem. We get comfortable. We do. We get comfortable right where we're at. We get comfortable with a few extra pounds. We get comfortable with a nice cushy seat. We get comfortable in the lifestyle that we've grown accustomed to. We just get comfortable. We become complacent. Change will never take place as long as we're comfortable and complacent. Complacency leads to destruction. Solomon tells us that it can't be business as usual. Listen, I can change, but I can't change unless I decide I'm going to make a change. Unless I really, truly want to change. That's the only way that change will come about. You know, most of us, we're so comfortable where we're at that we deny the problems. We have financial problems. You know what people do when they find themselves in financial difficulty? It's the oddest thing. You know what they do? Dan, you know what they do? They go spend more money. Tell me that makes sense. But that's exactly what we do because it makes us feel better. We don't admit that we've got a problem. We just go spend more money. We have relationship problems. You know what we do? We don't admit that we've got a problem with a relationship. We go out and find somebody else to be in another relationship with. And we just carry the baggage from this one into the next one. You see, the reality is that change can come, and it can come in me, but I've got to decide I'm not comfortable with life as usual. I'm not going to settle anymore. I want to go to that next place, that next level. Listen, you cannot change what you refuse to confront. If there's an area of your life, an area of my life that needs to change, then I'm going to have to admit that it needs to change. If there's an area of our spiritual life that needs to change, then we're going to have to not only be the child of God, we're going to have to be brave enough to say, I need to change. I got to want to change. I have to have that desire to be changed, to be different. Third thing we discovered. Third condition that has to be met. First condition, must be a child of God. Second condition, I got to want to change. Third condition, notice what it says. If I can become honest with God, I can change. Honesty is really important. Listen to what it says. For the Lord gives wisdom from His mouth, and from His mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. I love that. He stores up sound wisdom for the straight, for those that are straight shooters, those that are willing to admit to their problems, those that are willing to stand before Him uprightly. He is a shield to those who walk straight, who walk uprightly. There's no promise to the pretenders. Most of you know by now that I've been working out. I have. Work with Nate Brown. Yeah, I got to be honest with you. Once in a while, my wife, she works in Blue Springs, so once in a while we go over and I go to where she works out. And so one day I'm over there and I'm on the treadmill, right? And I'm walking on that treadmill and I notice this woman coming out of the dressing room. And man, she is dressed to exercise. You know what I mean? I mean, she's got the sweatband around her head and the wristbands with sweat and got the big new aerobic shoes on. And what are those? you know, I call them leg sweaters. I don't know what you call them, those little ankle things, you know, that the women wear. And she's over there, and she comes strutting out, you know, and she goes over and she starts picking up weights. And this is what she does. She goes, and she puts them down, and she goes to the snack bar. I don't see her doing anything else. She goes to the snack bar. Now, I got to tell you something. She looked the part, but she was lying to herself and to everybody else about her intentions. Now, you know, I started thinking about that, and I said, you know what? Sunday morning rolls around, and I get up, I look pretty good this morning, you know? And I come in, and you come in, and we're all dressed the part. Hold your Bibles up when you found it, and we start pumping that Bible. And you know what? Some of those 50-pound Schofields get pretty heavy. But our minds are going, gee, I wish I was at the snack bar. You see, sometimes we deceive ourselves. We're not shooting straight. You can't have this condition has to be met before we can expect the results. We've got to be a child of God. We've got to be honest with God. We've got to truly want to change. It is that honesty thing where we're walking straight, where we're admitting that we've got a problem. Where we're saying, you know what? This needs to change in my life. God, I want to be straight with you. I want to be straight. The movie, I don't know. I never saw the movie, but I've seen it advertised on Netflix. I Know What You Did Last Summer. You ever heard of that, the title? I've seen the title. I've never seen it. I'm not recommending it at all, but it just made me think. God knows what you did last summer. In fact, He knows what you're going to do this summer. In fact, He knows what you're thinking right now about, gee, I wish I was at the snack bar. God already knows. See, we may as well be honest with Him because He is smarter than we. He is pretty smart. You see, I can change. Repeat it after me. I can change. Here's the condition. I must be His child. I have to really want to change. I've got to cry out. That's what He said. See, I didn't go through chapter 2. Listen to these words. Treasure, listen, apply, cry out, lift up, seek, search. That's the activity that we do. I got to want it that bad. When was the last time you cried out, God, I need some help here. Give me some wisdom. I got to be His. I've got to want it, and I got to be honest. So what kind of results can I expect? If those conditions are met, what's going to happen to me? I know I'm going to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. No. See, if that's where we stop, and that's what too many churches want to stop at, we're way too shallow. We're not getting into the real impetus that may in fact come with everything else, but that's not the focus. The ifs we've seen, if I am God's child, if I stop settling for life as it is, if I'm honest with God, then I can change. Once those conditions are met, let's look at it. Roman numeral 2 in your outline. When those conditions are met, I can change. Number one, if those conditions are met, number one, I will find God's wisdom. I will find God's wisdom. He has it stored up for me. Then you will understand the fear of the Lord. Then you will find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom from His mouth, and from His mouth comes understanding. Fear of the Lord is the beginning. That's the elementary principles. I need to be fearful of Him, but I need to not stay fearful of Him. I need to grow in my relationship with Him. I need to continue to mature. If the conditions are met, then I can embrace the wisdom of God and apply it to my life. Now let me tell you something. The winds of change are blowing all around us. There's only two options. You can build a wall up to protect yourself from it, or you can build a windmill and tap into the potential that it has. And what we need to be as God's people are those people that are busy building windmills. We need to be the ones that are tapping into that resource that's blowing across us. When you and I are God's children, when you and I want to change, when you and I are seeking His face, listening to His Word, embracing it, and applying it daily to our life, when we're doing our part, when we're doing the ifs, the then will be we will discover His wisdom. His wisdom will change a life, not my ideas. Listen, those jokes about light bulbs are not going to change your life, but the Word of God rightly applied to your life will transform who you are. It will make a difference. It will change us from the inside out. It will change us. I would suggest that we start building windmills. The winds of change are blowing. Let's tap into the wisdom of God and use that to grow us, to be the people that we need to be. Second thing, if the conditions are met, not only will I find God's wisdom, number two, then my character will change. There's going to be this transformation. I'm not just changing the way I think. I'm also changing the way I live. I'm changing my character. Listen to what he says. Then you will understand righteousness and justice and equity and every good path. Character will change. Changing character. I live right. I live just, and I'm just in my dealing with other people. I'm a person of integrity. I treat everybody the same. That's the kinds of outcomes that I should be able to expect if I'm the child of God, if I really want to change, and if I'm being honest with Him. That's the kind of output we can look for. Suddenly our character begins to be altered. You know, God only has two ways to change character. One is the easy way, and that's to take His wisdom and apply it daily to our life. That's the voluntary way. There's another way that He changes our character, and that's sometimes through trials. Sherry sang about it, through the tears, through the trials. When I was a little boy, one of my birthdays, I got a piggy bank. I think it must have been a promotional item from the bank or something, a little glass piggy bank. It was orange, had a slot in the top. You guys know the ones I'm talking about? But it had no plug in it, so there's no way to get the money out of it except breaking the piggy bank or shaking it. I got really good at shaking it. You know, you turn it upside down and you shake it just right and the coins get in the slot and then they start slipping out. You know what I mean? Listen, I knew there was something of value inside that piggy bank. I could see it, but I couldn't get to it without shaking it. Let me tell you something. God sees the value in you. And He sees the value in me. And sometimes He can bring that value out because we get into His Word and we apply it consistently to our lives and the value just naturally begins to come out. But sometimes we're a little bit hard-headed. And it takes a shaking of our lives in order to get the value that is in us outside of us. In order to get this development of character that is deep inside us, this potential to be more than we are, I can change. The question is, am I going to choose the easy way or the hard way to get there? Solomon says, it is the wisdom of God that is accessible to us that can help bring about that change. Solomon says that sometimes, though, it is through the tears that we get to the blessing, and it's through the trials that we get to the blessing. It is in those processes of the shaking that God brings about our character. See, I can change, and you can change. Repeat it after me. I can change. Third thing. If the conditions are met, then I will find God's wisdom. If the conditions are met, then my character will change. Third thing, then my heart will be renewed. This is already the Son of God. This is already the Son. Remember, that was the way the passage opened. But now my heart is being renewed. Listen to what it says. I love this. When wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, then discretion will preserve you and understanding will keep you. It's an ongoing process of renewal. God doesn't just want us to change this outward appearance. He wants it to get deep inside us. He wants it to get in our heart. He wants it to become part of our soul, part of who we are. It is the application of His Word consistently over time that begins to transform who we are. That's how it gets into our heart. It's the overtime part. We don't just give up because of the challenges that it may bring. I started working out with Nate and Kelly Brown in January, and I got to tell you, that first month, it was murder. The temptation was there to quit because the challenge was too great. Melissa, you were there. It was tough. It was hard getting up and down out of chairs. And you know, the temptation's there to quit. But I didn't. I just kept going. I did what I could do, and then I kept doing a little more and kept going and kept going. I keep trying to quit. Then I turn around and sign up for it again. Because over time, it has become part of my life. It's gotten beyond just the outside part of who I am. Now let me tell you how this works. you and I become believers and followers of Christ. But we don't always have, the foundation is not always strong enough, and we run into challenges with life and we turn our back on God. You do realize in the last 13 years, if everybody who's been baptized by this church in the last 13 years showed up on the same Sunday, we'd have 1,000 people here today. But see, what happens to them is they start out good, but because there's no foundation, they don't keep going. They run into those challenges and they give up. They refuse to consistently apply the Word to their lives over and over and over, and then they walk away. It never gets into their heart. It never becomes part of who they are. It never is pleasant to their soul. See, the reality is I can change, but in order for me to change, then my heart has to be renewed. I've got to get to that place where my heart is transformed, where my heart is changed. Last one. Stay with me here. One more. Then, when the conditions are met, then I can expect my lifestyle will change. Notice what he says, and I just pulled these out randomly. To deliver you from the way of evil, to deliver you from the immoral woman, so that you may walk in the way of goodness and keep to the paths of righteousness. If the light bulb goes off, then lifestyle should change. If I begin to embrace the wisdom of God and I begin to apply the wisdom of God to my life and I begin to understand His wisdom and my character begins to change and my heart has been renewed, then before long my character should change. My lifestyle should be altered. All of a sudden people should look at me and go, "You've changed." Now you know when they say you've changed, what you want to hope is that what they mean is you're no longer living my life. You see, the truth is, before I became a follower of Jesus Christ, I lived the same life everybody else lived. But I don't intend to live that life anymore. I want to live a different kind of life. I want to live a changed life. And that only comes through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I want people to look at me when I go home and say, "You've changed." Because they recognize I no longer live their kind of life. But listen, let me tell you something. I don't want to live my kind of life. The transformation is not over if I just don't live like you or like somebody else. The transformation is not over if I just live my own life. The transformation isn't over until I live His life. See, the purpose of the transformation, the purpose of this wisdom, is so that I can begin to conform more and more to the image of God's Son, Jesus. It is His life that I seek to live. It is His life that I desire to live. But let me tell you, there are challenges to it. Love your enemy? My goodness. That's what He said. Anybody besides me have trouble loving your enemies? I see none of you raising your hand. Your enemy must be here today. You see, the reality is I can change. I desire to change. I want to change. Lord, I can't do it in my own. I've got to have You. See, that's the requirements. That's the if part. I am Your child. I really do want to change. But I can't do it in my own. I need you. And if I come to God that way, then according to Solomon, I can expect change to take place. I can discover His wisdom to apply it daily to my life. I can discover that my character will begin to change and I'll begin to treat people differently. I'll discover that my heart's being renewed day by day by day, moment by moment, that something is getting to become part of my lifestyle. And all of a sudden, my external stuff begins to change because my life is different. It's for Him. So how do we begin? How do we begin this process? Three things. Number one, first thing, you got to become part of His family. You must accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by Me." You can't be His son, you can't be His daughter, you can't be the Son of God, the daughter of God, without first coming to Him through Jesus Christ. I know it's real popular in the world today to say, "Oh, we're all God's children." That's not true. We are all God's creation. But because of the fall of man in the Garden of Eden, none of us are His children by nature. We are all lost, but we can be adopted into His family through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We must accept Jesus as our personal Savior, become part of His family. Second thing, we have to commit ourselves to follow Him. We have to make a choice and a decision. You know what? I want to change so badly that I'm willing to risk taking His word and applying it to my life in a day-by-day kind of way. I want to change. I'm tired of business as usual. I'm tired of life as it is. I want life as it could be. I want to do it His way. And then lastly, I'm going to trust Him to transform me. I'm going to be honest enough to admit, Lord, I'm going to stand before You straight today and tell You, I can't change in my own power. I've tried it. I'm an utter failure at changing. But I can trust You to transform my life into the person You want me to be. Accept Him, commit to Him, and trust Him. I can change. How about you? I can change. Repeat it after me. I can change. Let's bow together. Father, thank You for the truth of Your word, for the power that's found in it.